So good morning and good afternoon and good evening to all of you who are joining us from across the world for today's panel, which is organized by the India-China Institute at the New School in New York. So the topic for our panel today is the ecological question in global health. It's an urgent and important issue, especially in wake of the recently concluded COP26 negotiations and of course the ongoing pandemic. The COVID-19 pandemic has brought to public attention in a rather vivid way the multifarious interactions between environment and climate change on the one hand and public health and global health on the other hand. Urbanization, habitat destruction, intensive agriculture, air pollution, global travel, global food chains, all are being flagged as being intimately related to questions of infectious disease spread and health more generally. However, these interactions between the health of the planet and the health of people, even as they become increasingly vivid, they are juxtaposed against a long-standing siloization of the fields of climate change and environmental studies on the one hand, and global health, public health on the other hand. These silos are reflected in academic disciplines, they are reflected in national policy and regulatory realms, in global governance regimes, and perhaps most profoundly in mainstream analytical frameworks. So in this panel, our hope is to have a conversation about bridges and convergences between climate change and global health. We hope to discuss conceptual frameworks, governance approaches, and policy approaches that can address in the same space questions of both these realms and their interactions. And we are especially interested in how these convergences might be taking place in India and China. So for this conversation, we are very excited to have a diverse panel of speakers who span different disciplinary and sectoral expertise. The plan will be that I'll introduce the speakers very briefly, who will then proceed with their talks. This will be followed by a question answer session. I should note that the audience should put their questions in the Q&A box. The chat function will be closed to the audience. So our first speaker will be Dr. Lyle Fernley. He is Assistant Professor of Anthropology at the Singapore University of Technology and Design. He is the author of the very timely book, Virulent Zones, Animal Disease and Global Health at China's Pandemic Epicenter. The book was published in 2020 from Duke University. Dr. Fernley's research interests are at the intersections of the ecologies of health, food, and human environment configurations, especially in China and Singapore. Our second speaker will be Dr. Yifei Li. Dr. Li is Assistant Professor of Environmental Studies at NYU Shanghai and also the Global Network Assistant Professor at NYU. In the 21-22 academic year, he's also serving as a China-US Scholars Program Fellow at the Institute of International Education. He is the co-author of the also very timely book, China Goes Green, Coercive Environmentalism for a Troubled Planet. It was published in 2020 by the Polity Press. Our third speaker will be Mridula Paul, who is a lawyer and environmental policy specialist. She is a member of the International Union of Conservation of Nature's Sustainable Use and Livelihoods Specialist Group and is the editor of Courting the Environment, which is a newsletter that aims to convey environmental and ecological research to lawyers. She was a senior policy analyst with the Indian environmental group ATRI, but is now based at the Department of Geography, Policy and Development at the University of Northumbria in the UK as a postgraduate researcher. Our final speaker, and I hope he'll be able to join us, but if not, we'll be able to play a video presentation by him, is Dr. Arunabha Ghosh. He is the founder CEO of the Council on Energy, Environment and Water, a leading climate think tank that's based in India. Dr. Ghosh holds a range of positions in intergovernmental and governmental committees on environment and development. I won't be able to list all of them, but just very quickly, he serves on the UN Committee for Development Policy, is the co-chair of the World Economic Forum's Global Future Council on Clean Air, and is the member of the International High-Level Panel of the Environment of Peace Initiatives. He is the co-chair of India's Energy, Environment, and Climate Change Track for the country's forthcoming Science, Technology, and Innovation Policy, and in fact, just returned from the COP26 negotiations. So we are very privileged and lucky to have this diverse panel. The person who will go first will be Dr. Fernley. So, Lyle, the stage is yours.
Well, good day, everybody. And thank you, Manjri, and the other organizers from the India-China Institute. I'm going to just quickly share my slides. I hope everyone can see that. So my talk today, So my talk today is called What is a Wild Animal? And I'm referring to this as an ecological question in global health. And so my interest here is to look at the role of the wild animal in emerging infectious diseases and how that's been framed as a problem within global health. Over 70% of emerging diseases originate in animals, and especially wild animals, according to the WHO. And this includes diseases such as COVID-19, but also influenza, HIV, Ebola, and many others. As a result, the global health effort to prevent pandemics has long been intertwined with an ecological problem, for it's the relationships between humans and wildlife that poses the risk for a spillover of viruses into the human population and the origin of these pandemics. But the crucial question, I think, that we need to consider about this, about the wild animal, and is which ecology are we thinking of? So how exactly is ecology being put to work in global health? How can it be put to work? And in particular, I want to address this by looking at how the wild animal has been treated in different ways as a scientific object and as a site of intervention in global health. So in the response to COVID-19, we saw how the wild animal was quickly identified as the probable source of a new emerging virus. Based on somewhat disparate evidence, such as the original epidemiological cluster at the this Wuhan market where wild animals were sold, as well as the sort of genomic evidence showing that the virus is closely related to a bat virus, a clear line of accusation took hold that wild animals were the source of this virus and that wildlife consumption and trade had driven its emergence. Now, you're probably familiar with the this image that was originally circulated on social media suggesting that the origin was a bat soup, and which was widely criticized as false, xenophobic, and racist. But actually, in China as well, both scientific experts and the public called for a ban on wild animal consumption and trade. Importantly, advocates for a ban described wild animal consumption as backward and traditional. And in February 24th of 2020, China actually issued a complete ban on wildlife as food. So what we see here in this response is really a characteristic way of understanding the wild animal in global health as a reservoir of emerging diseases. The concept of reservoir is very telling here. It's a holding place for diseases, implies that our effort to prevent the emergence of disease should focus on practices or techniques of containment to contain these diseases in their source, their reservoir, the wild animal. But what exactly is a wild animal? Is their consumption traditional in China or elsewhere? And more importantly, is this a meaningful way of addressing emerging disease risk or of addressing the ecological question in global health? Now, anthropologists, I'm an anthropologist myself, I probably should have said at the beginning of the talk, anthropologists have long described how variations in the understanding of the boundary between the domestic and the wild that vary from across cultures. and across historical times. And this is one work here by Tim Ingold in his early work on reindeer farming, where he shows, or he argues that this idea of domestication actually is a kind of a simplistic overarching term, and actually is covering at least three different, very distinct kinds of human-animal relationship, which he calls taming, breeding, and herding. And so we often lump these together as domestication or domestic animals, but he shows that actually these are very different practices, very different ways of humans can relate to animals and imply very different consequences. In my own previous research on pandemic influenza preparedness in China, I examined how the discovery of farmed wild animals disrupted scientific assumptions about the interface between the wild and the domestic. So basically, influenza researchers, and what you're seeing on the left screen is a paper by a group of influenza researchers. They believe that the contacts between wild and domestic birds was the main source for the emergence of new flu viruses. And so they felt that if we could understand that interface between the wild birds and the domestic birds, where they overlapped in time and space, then we would be able to sort of create this boundary and contain the viruses before they spread into humans. But what they found unexpectedly is that many villagers had begun to farm wild animals or farm wild swan geese. And this completely disrupted their imagination of where the boundary between wild and domestic lay. So as I investigated this further, I found that farming of wild animals really, or farming of these wild swan geese in particular, was not in any way a traditional practice, but it actually emerged as a growing industry and emerged in response to the kind of industrialization of poultry in China over the past 30 years. That industrialization of conventional poultry, it kind of drove farmers to look for new kinds of niche markets. And they thought of themselves as innovators for finding this way of sort of selling a more high value food product. I asked one farmer, so do you consider your animals wild or domestic? And so he explained to me, it's not really one or the other, because what he explained to me is that these animals that he was raising were classified as tuzhong yangzhi, or special type animal farming within China's regulatory system. This meant that these animals were regulated and sort of managed under the State Forestry Administration rather than the Ministry of Agriculture. And within this category of tuzhong yangzhi, a very wide variety of kinds of farming actually was taking place. So you had sort of these specialized producers, such as the wild swan goose farmers that I met, which is really, I feel, quite akin to the kind of organic farming movements you might find in Europe and the US. In fact, in my own hometown, north of Boston in the United States, there's an alpaca farm and a reindeer farm that have emerged in the past 20 years in response to the same kind of niche markets that you see those wild swan geese. But you also have industrial mink farms raising sort of hundreds of thousands of animals in the northeastern fur production belt. And then you also have the more sort of widely known cases of medicinal animals like bears farmed for bear bile, tigers, pangolins, and deer. Now, an important aspect of this fact that they are regulated under State Forestry Administration rather than Ministry of Agriculture relates to sort of what kinds of regulations were applied to them. So what it means is that many of the veterinary rules and regulations applied to domestic animals actually didn't apply there. So notably, China has a universal poultry vaccination policy for influenza, for HPAI, highly pathogenic avian influenza. However, this did not apply to these wild swan geese. So in the area where I was doing research, you would have domestic poultry farms like right next to these wild goose farms. But the same, even though the species sort of genetically, it's not very different, but the policies of sort of whether this vaccination would apply is very different. I think I've argued elsewhere that some of the risks that are often associated with wild animals and wild animal farms may actually have to do with the different way they are regulated rather than the fact that they are wild. so-called wild animals. So as I mentioned in response at the beginning, in response to the COVID-19 outbreak, China issued a complete ban on wild animals as food. And so what has happened in the aftermath of that ban? Well, in fact, the problem of defining what counts as wild versus domestic has actually remained and persisted. So interestingly, the policy which has now come into effect has actually prohibited the farming of wild animals for food. So anything classified in that former system of the of special type farming has actually, that has been eliminated. But interestingly, a number of species that were previously listed under that category were, have been recategorized as special type livestock. In other words, almost like special type domestic animals. So as you can see here, including red deer, reindeer, alpaca, but also notably mink, blue fox, and raccoon dog, animals raised for fur, not for food. So the new category explicitly includes and permits some of these wild animals like mink. And why? So why might this not be a very sort of meaningful or effective response to emerging infectious diseases, so response to the ecological question in global health? First of all, and most importantly, I think the role of domestic animal farming is completely ignored in this kind of policy. And though many emerging diseases have actually been seeded by domestic animals, and seeded or sort of expanded in their spread by domestic animals. More specifically, in this case, we see here that fur animal species, which are known to be affected by COVID-19, and some people theorize may have actually been one of the originating animals for COVID-19, are actually still permitted under this policy. So as we recognize the importance of the ecological in global health, I suggest that it's also important for us to move beyond thinking about ecological risk in terms of fixed static categories, such as the category of wild animal. Instead, we can think more about the practices or processes through which humans engage with animals, our human-animal relations, such as how are animals actually hunted or farmed, at what scale, what kinds of regulations apply to it, what are the networks of trade and exchange. Human practices are constantly displacing the boundaries of the wild and the domestic. And what I'm showing here is how one of the farms that I know that used to be farming the wild swan geese, they're now shifting into ostrich farming in response to this regulatory policy. And so I think if we want to understand, really understand ecological risks in global health, we need to understand how innovative and anthropogenic transformations of ecology may produce these risks. And so we need to develop systems, not just for sort of prohibiting our contact with wild animals and containing diseases in the wild, but actually develop systems able to observe and understand the dynamic displacements that take place in human-animal relations. So I'll stop there and look forward to the questions afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lyle, for that really fascinating talk and, you know, how focusing on wild animal as a boundary object really puts a spotlight on how to think about both conceptualization, but also kind of pragmatic regulation and policy making when thinking about the ecological, you know, how to bring in, as you said, ecology and make it work in global health matters. So the next speaker will be Ife. Ife, over to you.
Great. Well, thanks, Manjari, for the introduction, and thanks, Lyle, for that great presentation. I learned a lot from it, and I think there are a lot of overlaps in the kind of observations, between the kind of observations that you're making and the kind of problems that I document in my own work. I'm a sociologist by training. I study Chinese environmental governance and look at some of the institutional matters at the macro level and some of the more micro day-to-day bureaucratic management of environmental issues in general. In my work, I've documented this increasing, emerging qualities of the Chinese state, especially under the climate crisis, in the sense that the Chinese state is increasingly using climate change in particular and environmental problems in general as, for lack of a better word, an alibi for intensifying authoritarian control. So we're seeing, in a book that Judy Shapiro at American University and I co-authored called China Goes Green, Coercive Environmentalism for a Troubled Planet, we document how not only domestically within the eastern, more industrialized areas of the country and the western, more ethnically diverse, the borderlands of the country, and even onto the Belt and Road across the Eurasia continent, Africa and beyond, even into the global commons, the Chinese state is now systematically upping their game, so to speak, in using authoritarian tools of government to regulate people's behaviors, to limit people's mobility, for example, and to pursue all kinds of interventions into everyday citizen lives in the name of protecting the environment, stabilizing the climate, and so on and so forth. So this, to give you a few examples, they use facial recognition cameras that are now quite pervasive in major metropolitan centers all over China. But at the point where ordinary residents dispose of garbage every day, they have now begun to install facial recognition cameras under the explicit justification of trying to make sure that everybody is recycling and sorting their garbage exactly according to the specifications of the state. So these facial recognition cameras are meant as a mechanism to ensure that there is full compliance to the state's specification. And there will be penalties, although we don't have any evidence of actual penalties being imposed on violating citizens. But the letters of the policies have made it very clear that if individuals are caught on camera for misplacing a certain type of recyclable, there will be fines and even other kinds of penalties that can be involved. There are also all kinds of interventions with regard to technologies, the use of all kinds of technologies to track people's movements. And these technologies are becoming now under the context of COVID, widely used by Chinese state authorities and all kinds of state authorities, from public safety to public health management to transportation agencies. These mobility tracking algorithms and apps and tools are being used by state authorities to determine, quote unquote, the risk of any given individual in terms of their potential exposure to confirmed cases of COVID patients, COVID infections. And based on this big data algorithm that they've created, and we should also know that every province within China has its own algorithm for determining risk levels. And it's oftentimes color-coded into green, meaning relatively low to no risk, yellow, meaning medium risk, and red, meaning very high risk. And different jurisdictions have different rules for determining what kind of quarantine measures or mobility restriction measures need to be imposed on these citizens, depending on their risk levels. Now, this, again, is a tool that is beginning to be widely used under COVID, but it's not something that's new as a result of COVID. It's a kind of technological tool that the Chinese state has been actively investigating and developing and perfecting for well over a decade. But COVID gave the Chinese state renewed momentum for actually beginning to ramp up their investments in these surveillance and behavior modification tools that previously were only in developmental and infant phases, if you will. So what we're seeing, as a result of the climate crisis, is that the Chinese state uses the climate crisis as an alibi for initially developing and growing a fairly substantial repertoire of surveillance technologies, both domestically and internationally. But as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, they've not only, they've continued on the same trajectory, if you will, to bring a lot of these tools that previously were in development into mass use. And this mass use has caused a lot of problems in some of the locations in China. They've pursued this highly coercive, draconian, if you will, interventions into people's behaviors. There was one case in China not so long ago, I want to say maybe a month or so ago, where there were a dozen or so confirmed cases of COVID-19 infections. And the local government all of a sudden decided to turn all of the city's traffic lights into red lights. And police officers were told to patrol the streets and find anyone who, quote unquote, were running the lights. But there were red lights all over the city. They were trying to restrict individual mobilities to the point of not allowing any mobility in the city at all. So this is the, you know, a fairly rudimentary use of technologies, but it gives a very good snapshot of the kind of the great length that they're willing to go in order to achieve some level of control in the case of the pandemic. Now, what we're beginning to also see is there are news reports coming out of Hong Kong of how political dissidents in Beijing are denied re-entry back into Beijing once they've left the city under the explicit excuse of them having traveled outside the city and potentially having been exposed to some level of risk. And therefore their re-entry is being denied, not because they're political dissidents, but because their health code, their travel code has turned from green to red, I believe in many of the dissident cases that were reported in Hong Kong. Now, we don't know for sure if these dissidents were actually denied simply because they were labeled as dissidents in the system. And that's because the algorithm and the tools that they use to determine levels of risk are extremely opaque. And nobody really knows what each and every province and jurisdiction is doing with regard to actually gathering the data and using that data to generate a specific color for every citizen. So on that score, the lack of transparency and the lack of accountability is becoming a real challenge. Individuals, if they are assigned a wrong color, if there is some information in the database that the government operates misrepresents the actual extent of mobility of the individual, it can be a real challenge because citizens don't have a way of challenging or even requesting corrections whenever the system goes awry. So these are some of the domestic issues with regard to how the climate crisis and the COVID-19 pandemic is being increasingly folded into a highly authoritarian and increasingly intensely authoritarian mechanism and apparatus of the Chinese state. But also internationally, we're seeing a growing market, if you will, that is hungry for the kind of governmental technicalities and governmental tools and instruments that the Chinese state has developed. My colleague Sophia Kalantzakos is in the audience. For those of us who have spent time at NYU Abu Dhabi, we know that the Abu Dhabi government has also invested in the kind of color-coded mechanisms for marking individuals with regard to their risks to COVID exposure. And that technology, the core of that technology is Chinese technology. The government of Abu Dhabi actively purchased that material from China in an effort to put together a coordinated attempt to maintain stability and order in Abu Dhabi under the pandemic. So we're seeing a market in places like Abu Dhabi, Morocco, Iran, and you name it, and these illiberal regimes seemingly very hungry for the kind of technology that there is on the ground in China. So, you know, if there is any prediction that we can make about the increasing prevalence of coercive tools in the management of climate, ecological, and public health crises, I think it seems very evident that outside Western liberal democracies, coercion is going to see a rise, and it's going to see a rise not only within China, but also in many of the other illiberal regimes around the world. I'll pause here and thanks again to Mondri and everyone at the India-China Institute for organizing this great event. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Ife. It's a fascinating talk because in some ways it is a great example of how convergence within governance regimes is taking place within these realms of climate change, environmental governance on the one hand, and public health and global health on the other hand. But it's taking place through these technologies of control, which you, as you point out, are fundamentally opaque to various publics and audiences. So I think we already have kind of lots of fascinating themes and connections to be talking about, but I'm excited to go to our third speaker, Mridula Paul.
Hi, thank you, Manjari, and thanks to everyone at the India-China Institute for hosting this very important event. So I want to touch upon, on the issue of the ecological questions surrounding health, I want to really pick on one, which is One Health, which is one of the conceptual tools and devices that's used as a potential solution or a way of addressing the issues that we've just been talking about. And I don't want to spend too much time on it, but just to give an idea to those who are not familiar with this area is largely One Health came from a veterinary science background that its antecedents are in that, but it really talks about zoonoses. It talks about, using it as a tool to tackle zoonotic diseases. And we have a lot of the recent intergovernmental reports that coming out, which talk about how pandemics have their origin in these diverse microbes, and talking about how they're driven by human activity. And here I want to clarify that by human activity, it's talking about the same kind of processes, the industrialization processes, the things that have already caused degradation, the things that have already caused climate change and biodiversity loss are now being implicated in the emergence of zoonoses. In fact, one of the latest studies tells us that the emergence of zoonotic diseases are on the rise, and there's more than 500,000 viruses capable of jumping from animals to humans. And this, Lyle, in fact, very effectively touched upon the animal reservoir concept. So I'm not really focusing on that, except I just wanted to show the map just to give an idea of this idea of hotspots, which is the language that's being used around the emergence of infectious, of zoonotic diseases. And as we know, about 60% of them are of animal origin, and of that, about 72% from wild animals specifically. So what do we do now? So right, that's the point in which One Health comes up. And you have a lot of institutions from IPBES to FAO, OIE, which is the World Organization for Animal Health, World Bank, a lot of these organizations talking about One Health being a solution, being a sort of a conceptual device. And One Health really means that human health is seen as linked to animal health and environmental health, and that all of this is interlinked, and you cannot address one without really effectively addressing the other. So the whole looking at the human animal environment interface. Now, so I just want to move quickly on to zoonosis in India, because that's really what I want to focus on. And historically, I mean, of course, as in anywhere else in the world, zoonosis is a public health threat. Across the world, we have 1 billion cases, 1 million deaths per year. Worldwide, in India, plague has caused about 12 million deaths since 1898. We have rabies causing about 20,000 deaths a year. Brucellosis is important, which causes about 25 million rupees losses in cattle, buffaloes. It's also important to note that, being a developing country, there is close interaction with livestock. People live in close proximity, largely in rural areas, but also in some urban areas. People also have poor availability of public and veterinary healthcare facilities. And this is important because having poor healthcare affects, health naturally, but then also has, outcomes. I mean, it affects educational outcomes, livelihood outcomes. And so a study that, So before I move on to that, I just want to quickly show, this is just a map showing the spread of zoonotic vector-borne diseases in different parts of the country. Yes, so I just want to move on to the study that my colleagues and I at ETRI did, where we looked at the institutional structures surrounding basically what we looked at five national level central institutions, central ministries. And the idea was to see how each of them tackle or address zoonotic diseases in any way. So this could be, you know, in the form of some institution developing a vaccine. It could be vaccines for, cattle. So we picked these five institutions and wanted to look at what they really did in terms of zoonotic diseases. And when we plotted the interactions and the maps, this is what emerged. And the circles in the yellow is from the Ministry of Agriculture. The one below that is Ministry of the Animal Husbandry. We have and the blue one in the middle is Ministry of Health, which is talking about public health. We also had the biotechnology, the wing of the central government, and on the extreme right in the green is the Ministry of Environment. So the reason why this is important is when we plotted these institutional links and interconnections, we found some gaps emerging, particularly in the whole intersectorality point, and which is what One Health really keeps harping about. And in one way that we saw this emerging is in the case of brucellosis. Brucellosis, as we know, is an emerging, and especially in India, it is an emerging zoonotic disease. And you see that both the Ministry of Agriculture, the Ministry of Animal Husbandry, and to some extent, the Ministry of Science and Technology, which is the biotechnology wing, deals with brucellosis in one way or on the other. One has a national program on brucellosis, and the others focus on cattle and the veterinary side of things. But despite it being an emerging zoonotic disease, which has public health implications, there are absolutely no programs by the Ministry of Health on brucellosis. And similarly, despite it being an important zoonotic disease of wildlife, again, there's nothing from the Ministry of Health, Ministry of Environment either. It's also important that we see that a lot of these interlinkages and connections that you see are between the ministries of Agriculture and Animal Husbandry and to some extent health, public health. But wildlife really remains on, an outlier with very few links and linkages that we can see. So here I want to talk about zoonotic diseases primarily, and talking about who it really hits the hardest. And we know that it is already vulnerable forest, wildlife dependent communities, herder communities in developing areas who are hit the hardest. And we have studies that have come out recently, a year ago in India, which talks about fragmented natural landscapes with the high human and livestock populations that provide the perfect condition for the emergence of zoonotic diseases. And this amounts to about 300 million people in India who are at risk who are really in the line of fire in a sense. But these are not the people who have contributed to the emergence and the rise and this increase. Really, it's actually, this in the 70s and 80s, these international plantation projects in the Western Ghats of India, which has been linked to the rise of a zoonotic disease called the Cassanur forest disease, which kills about 500 people per year. And it's in a very small area, but we are increasingly seeing the spread to other parts of the country. We also have studies that link roads and logging for timber logging and roads that were created in the eastern provinces of Cameroon being linked to some other emerging other zoonotic diseases like Ebola and Marburg and HIV as well. We also have to see that a big cause for the emergence of zoonotic diseases is industrial livestock production, which amplifies the diseases from wildlife, as the first talk told us, and has the potential to do that. Urbanization as well poses risk. So species that, which have risk now have more opportunity to stay in human modified habitats. But what are the global responses that we largely see? The global responses that we are largely seeing is in terms of policing people. It's in terms of telling where they ought to eat, what they ought to eat, what they should hunt or not hunt, where they should live and not live, what people should be doing. And particularly these are the communities which I mentioned are already vulnerable to zoonotic diseases, who face the biggest brunt of it and who live in close proximity with livestock and wild animals as well. Whereas if you see, when we examined a lot of the international, the policy documents, from the various international institutions on One Health, when it comes to advising industry, it's really very, like, you know, again, very, very broad suggestions of they should have better disaster management plans. The policing people is what comes out as one of the key elements of the One Health approach. Another key challenge that the One Health approach faces is that public health healthcare is largely missing from it in terms of the existing deficiencies in infrastructure. The fact that we already have very poor public health, veterinary health facilities to boost them up to sort of bolster them, that again finds very little place in the One Health literature, and that's important. And just to point out in terms of health infrastructure and how it looks in different parts of the world, this is hospitals per, you know, per thousand people, and you can see the difference between high income countries, between in China, in the United States, South Asia, where it is, and India, which you can see is very low along. So while we can talk about One Health, as a device to tackle zoonotic diseases, we really also need to be talking about some basic fundamental things, like fixing just having enough beds available for people to fix basic public health infrastructure issues. And this is just another issue which tells you about some of the issues facing diagnostic capacities. A study that was done on acute febrile illnesses, so basically fever, the number of times people walk into a primary healthcare facility with fevers, and about 56% of the time this goes undiagnosed. So we can talk about grandiose concepts, but these are some of the fundamental issues where we still need to be working on. And that's really what I wanted to end this on, is that, yes, the ecological question is important, but there are some fundamental systemic issues that we need to fix. And I just wanted to show this image because this is sort of it's just the network of institutions that institutions and individuals that write on One Health. So this is a scholarship produced on One Health, and all the circles in black are from institutions of the Global North, and the circles in white are those of the institutions of the Global South, institutions or individuals. And you can see that the biggest networks are largely surrounding the institutions of the Global North. In fact, the study by Galaz and others mentioned that nearly 80% of the scholarship, the literature, the gray literature, in fact, surrounding One Health is coming from the Global North. And so the point of this is not to say here is this concept and it has problems. Sure, it does have problems, but the point is also not to say that here is a developing country which is not following this concept well. The important thing is to say when we come up with these concepts, when we have these devices to tackle zoonotic diseases, it's also important to understand what the ground realities are and what's actually possible and feasible, and what are the systemic changes as well that's needed to actually start tackling zoonosis and some of these ecological questions around health as well. Thank you very much, Ellen.
Thank you very much, Mridula. Again, a really interesting talk, which I think is in conversation with what Lyle and Ife said in so many different ways. So if Lyle's talk was talking about the importance of focusing on fluid processes and networks and interactions rather than fixed categories, Ife's was about how the regulation really has been translated and understood as a politics of control. And in so many ways, your talk about how One Health is being operationalized in the Indian context echoes that, how the emphasis is on politics of control rather than looking at these intersectoral, more fluid interactions. So I have heard that our fourth speaker, Arunabh Ghosh, won't be able to join us, but he has sent a presentation. So we will just play that presentation. I also want to make a note that the audience should please put their questions in the Q&A box. So we'll take that after Arunabh's presentation is finished.
Good morning. And good day to everyone listening in into this webinar. Thank you, Dr. Mahajan, for inviting me to participate in this very important discussion on the ecological question in global health. I must start with an apology that I've not been able to join you live during the session due to an urgent meeting that has come up with senior government officials here in India. But I am taking this opportunity to record my presentation and I hope it can contribute in some ways to the discussion that will follow. I will present to you a thesis around what I believe should be the issues, at least sitting here in India, between connecting climate change and public health. And in the process, I will try to outline also some of the public policy interventions that would be necessary to respond to an evolving crisis. Let me start by introducing the Council on Energy, Environment and Water. We are an 11 and a half year old institution, ranked as one of the leading climate think tanks in the world and amongst the leading think tanks in Asia. Our work extends from here and now issues of energy access and scaling up India's renewables targets to looking at long-term issues around industrial sustainability and modeling the low carbon pathways and in fact the net zero pathways for India, as was announced just a few weeks ago. But the issue that particularly concerns me is that of risks and adaptation, because climate risks are not linear. They will compound and they will escalate as time goes by. And how we build resilience and adapt to a changing climate will test not just our environmental domain, it'll test our economy, it'll test our educational systems, it'll test our governance systems, and of course, it'll test our public health systems. Let me start by the first issue that I believe will be absolutely critical when we draw this linkage between climate change and health, and that is the rising spread of diseases. As the research across the world demonstrates, that a warming temperature makes it that much more likely that zoonotic diseases will become more frequent and more pervasive across the planet. Heavy rainfall and flooding can trigger widespread public health impacts due to waterborne and vector-borne diseases. Malaria is most likely to spread at 25 degrees Celsius, while the risk of Zika or the Zika virus spreading becomes highest at 29 degrees. So even marginal changes in a particular region's average temperature can then begin to trigger the spread of number of diseases. There is a 3 to 5% increase in the risk of malaria if global temperatures cross 2 to 3 degrees. Now, this is the track we are on. Of course, if every country promises and delivers on its promises, we might get to about 1.8 degrees, which is the latest analysis. But a likely outcome is that we are still well over 2 degrees of warming. So the spread of diseases is something that we have to be particularly worried about. From India, the other public health challenge that we have to concern ourselves about is facing the brunt of extreme weather events. At CEW, we've been developing the first high-resolution atlas for climate risks. And we believe it will be the first of its kind in the developing world of a resolution of 25 kilometers. What we already see in developing this atlas is that 3/4 of India's districts are now hotspots for extreme climate events, floods, droughts, and cyclones. And 1/4 of Indians are highly vulnerable to all of these three extreme events. Now, as you see from this slide, we have about 450 million people in India who are likely to be exposed to the risk of heat stress. 114 days of heat waves conditions were experienced every year in India as of 2019. In just one state in rural Andhra Pradesh in 2015, the heat wave resulted in 2,500 deaths. But this is just the situation as it is right now. And a warming climate will intensify this heat stress, which will result in both loss of economic value because of lost workdays. It will also result in a major public health challenge. As you can see from the table, these districts with very high heat vulnerability scores are largely centered around the central and the eastern and western parts of the country. So sort of the midriff of India, so to speak, stretching all the way from Gujarat in the west and Rajasthan to Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh in the center and all the way to Odisha and Jharkhand in the east. So focusing on these critical districts will be important to make sure that our public health interventions are incisive and that we are able to create the resilient infrastructure for public health to respond to these rising challenges. A third way to think about this is actually what it means for the poor and vulnerable in India, especially in a rapidly urbanizing India, again, from a public. Today, every sixth Indian household actually lives in a kacha or semi-pakka, means a informal settlement, informal house. But when we map that need for formal home dwellings and homesteads to the issue of rising climate risk, whether it's floods, drought, cyclones, or floods and droughts, floods and cyclones, and the compounding effects associated with them, we find that more than half of those households living in informal settlements are exposed to floods, cyclones, and their compounding impacts. 90% of those vulnerable households are located in 10 states. 55% of even existing permanent houses are exposed to floods, cyclones, and their compounding impacts. Why is this a public health problem? Because when a disaster strikes, it is not just the immediate loss of life that has to be prevented, but it is the compounding challenge associated with provision of water, sanitation, health facilities in an already vulnerable and impacted area. So as I said, at least from where I sit here in India, these are some critical issues. The chronic challenge of rising heat stress, of rising vector-borne diseases, but also an acute challenge of repeated effects of extreme weather events that impact our rapidly urbanizing and highly dense cities. So what should be the response? And again, in my final few minutes, I want to just outline at least three areas that we should be focusing on. The first is to have more integrated emergency response systems. And what we mean by that is that we need to de-risk India. And we've proposed in the aftermath of the pandemic that we have an environmental and health de-risking mission, which is able to look at and assess the way climate risks are going to impact our health systems, but also build up the capacity for emergency response and disaster management through a unified response framework, which means that you're involving not just the first responders, but you're also involving the communities. Every $1 billion invested can save $2 billion in emergency response expenses. The other approach at a household level from a health perspective should be in ensuring that we have more and more access to clean cooking energy. Over the last few years, 160 million people have gained access to clean cooking energy. And now more than 85% of Indian households have access to liquefied petroleum gas. At the same time, 600,000 people still die from indoor air pollution. And unless we can make our homesteads more healthy, public health challenge, and it will also remain a energy access and a climate challenge. And this is where India's approach to increasing access to clean cooking energy must be further supported with helping the households continue using the clean cooking fuels. Rather than just subsidizing the connections, we need to subsidize the fuel as well. The final aspect in building up that resilience at the local level would be to strengthen the public health infrastructure at the local level. Just one example from the state of Chhattisgarh in the east, which is one of the poorest states, shows that when Chhattisgarh went ahead and solarized more than 1,000 primary health centers, it could cater to patients 50% more than the centers that did not have similar installations. Even though 91% of our primary health centers have electricity connections, we see that many of them have irregular power supplies, which means storage of vaccines, which means treating of pregnant women in the primary health center, which is treating of children or those affected by heat stress, et cetera, becomes that much more hard. So we estimate that less than $100 million can actually solarize all primary health centers in India. So just in conclusion, I want to reiterate that while we understand the climate and the health risks in India from a localized perspective of vulnerable communities, whether it's heat stress, vector-borne diseases, exposure to extreme weather events, our resilience response should also be localized, whether it's solarizing primary health centers, whether it is ensuring that households have access to clean, non-polluting fuels for cooking, or whether it is making sure that we have a unified, integrated emergency response framework at a district and local level. Thank you again for your attention. And I apologize again that I'm unable to join in the discussion that will follow, but I hope that this has contributed to the understanding that I hope we'll get out of this, a very important webinar. Thank you again.
So thank you, Dr. Kirsch, in absent, who's not present here, for that interesting presentation. And in some ways, it really brings home the point that maybe Mridula also ended with, that even while these are global challenges, our both understanding, analysis, and definitely responses have to be grounded in local realities. So now is the time for a discussion, for a Q&A. So if all the panelists could be in the room. So we have questions coming in from various channels, which I'll start putting to the panel. And I request the audience to keep sending the questions through the Q&A box. The first question is from my colleague, Mark Fraser, who's the co-director of the India-China Institute. His question is to Lyle and Yifei in particular. He's asking, thinking about the fragmented authoritarian model of governance in the PRC, in which local governments have a vast array of unfunded mandates, do lower income areas with low resourcing and staffing have to fund the policies to enforce provisions against wildlife production, consumption, and facial recognition, COVID algorithm tracking, et cetera? Or are these policies centrally funded and enforced from more centralized layers of government? Would we expect authoritarian environmental governance to be stronger in the richer areas than in poorer areas because of budgetary resources? So Yifei and Lyle, whichever one wants to take this first?
I mean, I can give sort of an initial response. And, you know, I think that's a fascinating question, that on the one hand is a question about financial resources, but on the other hand, it's also a question about enforcement capabilities, government capacities, if you will, in handling some of these challenges. And in my own work, I've noted both of these dimensions to be challenges, especially for areas that are already economically and developmentally disadvantaged within China, in the sense that, yes, in some of the initiatives, there is some earmarked fiscal transfer from the central government, but oftentimes these fiscal transfers are not sufficient to cover the full cost of these initiatives. Sometimes, you know, it would be really interesting. I'll give an example in a minute. It'll be really interesting to examine cases in which there is a central mandate, which local authorities across the border are supposed to meet, where there are examples where this mandate gets systematically underperformed, undersatisfied across the board. And yet, there are other cases in which certain mandates are systematically over-enforced and overperformed by local authorities. Now, the over-enforcement example I have is when the Chinese central government demanded a rapid shift from fossil fuel and coal, in particular, fired heating facilities in northern China. They demanded a shift from all of that to liquefied natural gas as a main source of energy. And because it came at such a high level and it was framed as a personal demand on the part of the president, it resulted in a lot of anxiety on the part of the local officials, even though they didn't have the resources and capacities to enforce. They nevertheless wanted to achieve, you know, to the fullest possible extent that they can. And yet, precisely because they don't have the financial and enforcement capabilities, they had to resort to, you know, in Chinese, what's called a one knife cuts all approach, or yi dao qie approach. In English, it really translates to this cookie cutter approach, a one size fits all approach, to say that, okay, we don't have the enforcement capacity, we don't really have the technology, and the government is not in a position to provide a lot of the technical assistance. We're just going to pursue a full ban on coal-fired centralized heating. And they were smashing people's boilers, they were smashing some of the district level central heating facilities, and just forcing people to switch to liquefied natural gas. Now, in that example of over-enforcement, we see really tragic human costs, in the sense that because they shifted too fast, they shifted too aggressively, entire parts of northern China were left without heat for an entire winter. And they had to then, the Ministry of Environmental Protection got really worried, because it made them look really bad. And they sent something like 800 inspectors to all rural areas to give people, to give away free electric heaters. So that was an example of how there's not actually a whole lot of enforcement capacity, both financially and human resource wise, when it comes to some of these very, very ambitious governmental mandates coming from Beijing. And oftentimes we see underperformance simply because they don't have the resources, but sometimes overperformance can also cause tragedies and incur human costs that may not even be intended at the very beginning. I yield the floor to Lyle.
Thanks, Yifei. Yeah, I'm just going, that was a very good answer. So I'm just gonna add a few details related to wild animal farming in particular. So just seconding what Yifei already said, that I think in many cases, the issue may not be only about resources, but also about some kinds of commitment based on high level demands in very significant type situations, or maybe coming from the president, or in this case, related to COVID-19, that's added an extra sort of push to it. And what else, the evidence you see for that in this case is that after SARS in 2003, which was also traced to wild animals at the time, civet cats, a very similar kind of ban was put into place. But over time, after several years, things started to sort of gradually loosen up in terms of how that was regulated, and then more and more wild animal farming was taking place, until actually it was booming at a certain point after that. And so that's because the sort of significant energy symbolically related to that issue of regulating that trade really decreased over time after SARS. And then the second other point, that's just a slight other aspect, is that I would say that definitely that there's regional variation in terms of, there was regional variation. So I don't know much exactly about details about what's going on now, but there was regional variation in terms of how wild animal farming was regulated and promoted by province. And it has also to do not with whether they're able to regulate, but really about the value of that industry in those different provinces. So some provinces, like where I did the fieldwork, my fieldwork in Jiangxi province, it has a very high interest in sort of forestry related industry. And so that was a big area there. But it's something like in Beijing, of course, there's no interest in wild animal farming, so it would not be something that would be, so it would be regulated much more strictly.
Thank you, Yifei and Lyle. So we have another question. This one is from Nikki Gala from India, who's a first year MA psychology student at the New School. Her question is to all speakers, but she's asking, most of the studies talked about have a science and technology focus. I'm curious to know, are there observations on human behavior in response to the development of these studies, especially with acceptance to new technologies and new policies? So do any of you want to take on Nikki's question about...
I can start. But yeah, I mean, I think that's it's something that, you know, a few of us have really been thinking about, is that not just specific to this issue, but this whole idea of, you know, when we talk about science and the evidence base, we always have this idea that we sit in a room or wherever in the field and produce evidence, and then we give it to policymakers and they just run with it. But even so, you know, the whole human behavior, the whole psychology of decision making, even. So even that, like, how do policymakers make decisions based on the science that you give them on with regard to these ecological questions? And similarly, you know, with people, with communities, how do they react? I just don't know if we have enough research in that space. And I think it's really important to integrate and get insights from behavioral studies, from psychology, and all of that. I think it would add a huge dimension of understanding to this.
If I could also try to add to that a little bit, Nikki, I think that's a terrific question. And it's a kind of orientation that I myself has been advocating for in my own work, in the sense that I've been saying in pretty much all of my writings that whenever it comes to evaluating pieces of public policy, if we have an environmental policy at hand, our evaluation should not only look at the environmental consequences of this focal piece of policy, but also the non-environmental consequences of it. Because public policies, whenever they're implemented, there can be side effects, there can be unintended consequences. It can go awry over time. It could seem perfectly well in the immediate future, but in the long run, it causes a lot of problems potentially down the road, especially when it comes to environmental issues. Many of the problems aren't going to be immediately apparent until after a year or two, because the ecological system takes its time to respond to all sorts of human interventions. So you're absolutely right in pointing out that there needs to be a focus on the human dimension and how human societies respond to it. But also I'd even argue that in addition to how human societies respond to the adoption of technologies, if you will, or the introduction of all sorts of technical interventions into the ecological world, we need to attend to the most immediate short-term human reactions and the longer-term human cultural social costs and the longer-term non-human even social and ecological costs as a result of these policies. So attending to non-environmental consequences of environmental interventions and by implication, the non-public health implications of what seems like a purely public health piece of public policy. So yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's exactly what, you know, scholars in fields like political ecology, cultural geography, and all sorts of fields are actively trying to contribute as an interdisciplinary set of voices to contextualize these public policies that we're trying to look at in our own work. But great question.
Lyle, did you want to add something to this? I mean, in some ways, I think it really speaks to this broader question about what kind of expertise gets privileged in which particular kinds of forums, right? And I think there are very specific stories that emerge out of different local, national, and global governance contexts. And I know some of your own work, Lyle, has actually focused on which experts get to, as it were, determine the framework within which the problem would be posed in the first place, whether it be virologists or ecologists or so on and so forth. So I'm wondering whether you want to kind of take on this question about how, at least in wildlife management, but more broadly, what the story of expertise has been.
Right, so exactly. I mean, I think this is an excellent question in that this idea of the ecological in global health, I think, so we see that, you know, can easily see, you know, 70% of emerging viruses come from animals, many from wild animals. But so we have a lot of this kind of virological knowledge about the role of wild animals in creating these emerging diseases. But when it comes down to thinking about what are the human practices that are actually involved in driving the emergence, it's often at a much more simplistic and, you know, less sophisticated understanding about those practices, like its traditional consumption of wild animals, which is completely not related to reality, basically. And so that disconnect leads to some of the other issues that I think Ife and Radula are talking about in terms of policing of behaviors that A, are not really responsible for this problem in the first place, and then also leading to other kinds of consequences because we don't have an understanding of what kind of human behaviors really are significant and what we could, how we could maybe change those in a more sophisticated way.
Yeah, no, and I think one would hope that the pandemic has really brought home the need to complement, supplement, replace in some cases, a kind of exclusive focus on biomedical, scientific, technological expertise with also expertise from the social sciences, which actually, you know, studies and knows about how human behavior changes in particular contexts. We have a question, Mridula. I think it's a question slash comment mainly for you from Thresia CU, who's actually one of the fellows at the India-China Institute seminar on shifting geographies of expertise. So she has two different points that she wants to inquire about. The first is the pretty poor state of intersectoral coordination within the health sector and beyond. And it's something that, you know, you're talk definitely touched upon. And the second is about the social determinants of health for humans and others in the ecosystem beyond infrastructure, such as including beds. What is the policy for taking into account social determinants of health in the One Health approach in the Indian context?
Sorry, I didn't really get the first question, but I mean, should I just answer the second one? And
So I think the first was more in the form of a comment, which was about the poor state of intersectoral coordination within the health sector. So you might want to just elaborate on that.
So there is definitely poor intersectoral coordination, but then I don't think we can leave it there. I think it's also important to understand that these sectors came up in these ministries and, you know, how these sectors were organized came up in a particular context. It came up in a context, and now to expect it to change and then, you know, immediately sort of operate in a different way is just, you know, it's sort of expecting too much from systems that are just old and archaic and sort of stuck in its ways. So in even advocating for intersectorality, we have to keep that context in mind, and to, you know, which is why I was talking about the fact that we can come up with these concepts and these, you know, silver bullet solutions, but is that actually practical or practicable in some context where these silos have emerged for a particular reason and, you know, continue to operate for particular reasons? About the social determinants of health, you know, the fact is one of the biggest issues is that public health has been systemically and systematically underfunded in India over decades. And all of the studies, you know, social science studies have been telling us that India spends the pittance of its GDP on health, on public health. And you have increasingly systems that are pushing private health, cutting, you know, public health continues to get cut. So yes, so, you know, it's just, and so the reason I picked up things like hospital beds and diagnosis is that even at that stage, we're lacking. So, you know, just to say that this fundamentals that we're lacking, and I don't really see policies to address that. Policies that are coming up are more in terms of having insurance schemes and things that private sectors and corporations can benefit, and government really abdicating its social responsibilities. So I honestly don't see, I apologize for sounding terribly cynical, but really that's my answer to that.
No, thank you, Mridula. And in some ways, this point was also echoed by Arunabh Ghosh's presentation, that, you know, at the end of the day, one also has to think about infrastructural needs, very basic needs on the ground. So your pessimism seems to have to be broadly shared for good reason. So another question that we have from an audience member. So one takeaway from today's presentation, given the animal-human transmission of viruses and ongoing practices, along with global warming, is that another pandemic is a non-trivial probability? Do the panelists think that the governments, Chinese, Indian, US, others, are any more capable of managing the next pandemic? Are humans capable of managing the next one? So that's it.
I mean, fascinating question. I think there is so many things that I want to say about it, but I'll try to be brief. There's this issue, I think, both of my two colleagues, Lyle and Radura, talked about in your presentations, this issue of the source, right? The source of the pandemic. Governments seem quite preoccupied with figuring out that source and then throwing fire and fury on that source. I mean, I've seen these pictures of governments pursuing quarantine in places like South Korea, in Delhi, in many other places where the government would try so hard to say that this is the source. And these people are the first cases in our country. Lock them up, put them in a quarantine place, spread all the disinfectants that you can buy in your country and just spray and spray and spray. And, you know, the most extreme example that I personally witnessed was when I was in Abu Dhabi on our campus there at the beginning of the outbreak. And the government of Abu Dhabi was commissioning drone flights to spread disinfectants on the streets of Abu Dhabi in the hope that they would clean out the city of any possible viruses. And that attempt to deal with such a complex and interconnected ecological problem by identifying a one source and then try to lock up that source and get rid of it is just a wrong frame of mind to my eyes. I just don't think that is in any way a reflection of the actual complexity of the problem. And it also reflects a very serious lack of patience and lack of appreciation on the part of the governments for precisely the kind of issues that this panel is talking about. So, you know, I hope that, you know, what the governments have actually learned from the pandemic is that their at source thinking is fundamentally flawed. And they need to really part ways with that at source thinking and begin to think about more in more integrated fashion about the state of the world and what they can do.
If I can add, I just also wanted to, that was really, really important. And I just wanted to add this whole thing that if we really look at it and from this whole, you know, what we've been talking about, the words that we use, you know, hotspots and location, and like Yifei was saying, you know, the source, and also so identifying or pathologizing, is that the word? Anyway, but, you know, pathologizing a landscape or a set of people without really, again, taking these larger structural issues as to why we've come to this place where, you know, we have these, we've always had pathogens and we've always had spillovers, but the rate and extent at which these are happening. And for me, this whole idea that, you know, and I get asked this, I get asked about, you know, climate change and links to this. And I feel like at some level, we're really not talking about what the fact that we have an economic model, a system that's causing, you know, climate change is a consequence of all this. Biodiversity loss, extinctions are consequences of this. So is the emergence of zoonotic diseases and, you know, all of these and all of these impacts on health. But we're just talking about consequences affecting other consequences and never really talking about what is actually, you know, and while we continue to dam and mine and, you know, take ecologically sensitive islands and build ports on them. And even during the pandemic, in fact, the government sanctioned, you know, railway tracks in, you know, pristine rainforests in some parts of India, while talking about the fact that, yes, this is emerging out of, you know, because of this man's issues with nature and things like that. But this is just happening on the side. And I feel like this disconnect is really strange and jarring for me.
Yeah, I just want to jump in with one other comment about this source. So something I've been thinking about for a long time, sort of my book is actually a lot about this, how China was identified as the hypothetical source of pandemics, specifically around influenza. And one of the key things that the sort of vision of identifying sort of surveillance and rapid identification of the source has been for the sort of great part of the 20th century until now, is that if we did it rapidly enough, then we would be able to develop vaccines and actually prevent the spread and contain it at its source, right? Because you know, with humans, we're not going to do culling like we do with animals and wild animals and domestic animals, but maybe we would have the vaccines rapidly enough, we could actually contain it and prevent the harm from spreading. But the reality is that's up until now, that's still such a fantasy in terms of the speed. This virus emerged in a place that had some of the best surveillance capabilities, right? That was detected extremely rapidly. They had the sequence within like a month after it started to infect people. And, you know, even then you have at least 1 year till anyone was even vaccinated. And by that time, you know, it's too much of a disaster. So unless you can get vaccine development, which is getting faster, but unless it can get really, really fast, then I don't think it's possible to sort of prevent a pandemic at this point.
Yeah, no, I think all those comments are, you know, they really converge on, so it's absolutely right. The politics and the frameworks of pandemic preparedness up till now have really focused on this politics of control and containment, right? At source, and as Lyle, you were pointing out, speed has been really important. Surveillance reporting to centralized authorities has been really important. As we speak, there are negotiations for a new pandemic treaty or some kind of an international instrument that deals with pandemic preparedness in potentially new ways. And I think there's a real battle going on right now in that forum too, regarding what the new emphases should be and what lessons we should take away from both COVID-19, but also a longer history of international health that many of us have studied and pointed to, right? So should it also include an emphasis on routine health systems, Mridula, as you were talking about? Should it also include emphasis on not just new vaccine development, but also on treating vaccines and other medical countermeasures as global public goods in these kinds of situations? Should we be looking at structural issues of global economies? And I think the verdict is out regarding what kinds of frameworks will end up dominating new pandemic preparedness treaties, instruments, and also national policies. But you know, I found a real convergence in what each one of you were saying, right? So if you look at the terms that you all were emphasizing, and I was noting down some of this, so there are terms such as compounding challenges, interactions, fluidity, networks, intersectoral expertise, emphasis on resilience, emphasis on complexity, all of which are arguing away from an exclusive focus not only on sources, but also on a kind of narrow technological interventional approach. At least in certain expert domains, it seems as though there is quite a lot of consensus around what kinds of lessons should be learned and what kinds of frameworks should be adopted. I guess it's a question of whether that can be communicated forcefully enough to other domains and policymakers. I know, so we are supposed to go till 10:30, so we have another 5 minutes, but there is another question that I wanted to bring from the audience to the panel. It's how will increasing forced relocation impact health of humans and others in ecological systems? And this is from Laurie Johnston. And I wonder if one of you want to take that on.
So question. Relocation of people to.
I imagine it's a bit cryptic, isn't it? But I imagine it is relocation of people, perhaps in response to climate change crises that the last presentation discussed.
Yeah. I mean,
she's emphasizing forced relocation of humans.
Right, okay. Whether that has a, I don't know. I honestly don't know if that has been a recommended sort of course for, in terms of health, like a strategy for tackling health. I don't know. I wouldn't be able to comment on that. I don't know if anybody else wants to jump in.
I mean, it is quite a common recommendation for dealing with climate change crises, right? Mm. So forced, but also voluntary relocations from flood zones, right? I mean, in New York City here, that's a part of urban policy after Hurricane Sandy. You know, there are maps and zones and a whole lot of administrative infrastructure to try and institute these kinds of relocations, which of course is completely countermanded by new developments that take place on the water. Just, you know, it's a question of where the rich live and where the poor live, and a kind of differential implementation of these kinds of recommendations. But I wonder if any of Yifei,
I can say a little bit about that. I mean, one of the things that really was a major motivation for Judy Shapiro and I to co-write our book is that we were both taking note of this new term that the Chinese government has coined, which is called ecological migration. This is a term that they've used quite a lot, I'd say, for almost 10 years now. Since the development of the first, what they call a demonstration national park, the idea being that, okay, we're going to build a national park here. So in the name of ecological sustainability, we're going to have to move a bunch of people. And these people are going to be forced off of their ancestral lands. But we're going to call the process, we're going to give the process a nice name. And ecological migration is the nice name that they came up with it. And when I first heard the term, I had absolutely no idea what that term meant. I was like, ecological migration, how cool is that? I want to be one. And then I looked into some of the underlying problems, and I was just completely appalled by that entire process. It meant that essentially, that there is a government-imposed order on how humans and non-humans in the ecosystem are supposed to interact with each other. And then they impose that order by eliminating villages that have historically been on these lands for generations and generations, force them off of the land, move them into areas what they call the urbanization of the rural. And then at the same time constructed this highly organized and ordered ecological system within these national parks in China. And that's, you know, in a way, a familiar genre of history, if you will. Yellowstone, in many ways, is not so different from that model. Many national parks in the United States followed exactly that same approach. But to the question that Laurie Johnston is asking here, does that impact the health of humans and any others in the ecological system? Yeah, in every imaginable way. I mean, we're taking people off of the land. They have to adopt entirely new urban, modern, supposedly modern ways of life. And it also means that the ecological system of which they previously were a part now becomes subject to a state, quote unquote, scientific model of management. It becomes essentially part of the government's natural resource management program, as opposed to a self-sustaining ecosystem on its own. So yes, you're absolutely right. If the kind of ecological migration I'm describing is what you have in mind, Laurie, that would be my answer, at least given the Chinese context.
Yeah, and Yifei, you're right. There is a long history of several governments doing exactly this, right? And now there is a kind of new banner under which it can be justified. And so the kind of resources for justification and legitimation for these kinds of policies, there's new ammunition for it. So we have one, and what might be the last question, and Ridula, this is really for you from an audience member who's asking, we heard about technologies of surveillance being used by the Chinese government to deal with questions of both public health and climate change. Do you see any of this in the Indian context, which, as we know, with Aadhaar has the world's largest biometric identification system? Aadhaar or other kinds of digital surveillance tools being used for public health and climate change monitoring reasons?
Yes, yeah. So nothing of that scale. I mean, so, but yes, Aadhaar, of course, and with all its biometric, you know, it's this unique ID, which has a lot of information, and there's been a lot of issues with how safe the data is and things like that. But, you know, with COVID-19, the whole app, you know, the fact that you needed this particular app to get a vaccine, you needed to update, you needed to have your Aadhaar number or, you know, particular government ID, which would be recorded, which is then linked to a whole bunch of things. So I think COVID, the COVID-19 pandemic provided an opportunity to test some of these systems, which I think they were sort of thinking about or, you know, had in mind. It sort of played very nicely into that. In fact, initially there was also concerns about this sort of, there was this app that everybody had to have, which would tell you how many infected people were there around you. And some of this data got leaked. And, so you had then lists of people who were infected and with names and addresses and all of that coming out. So yeah, increasingly, definitely. And even I think there was also talk about a health ID. So again, like I said, like while systematically underfunding public healthcare, money is being spent on things like, you know, tracking, you know, these things as to where you're staying, what you're doing and things like that, which is deeply problematic in multiple ways.
Yeah, no, I think it is, you know, something that you see not only in China and India, you see it in countries around the world, really. And in some ways, the pandemic and its convergence with climate change even more so is allowing for a new, in some cases, maybe in the Chinese case, not new, experimental governance, right? Where governments are testing out all sorts of new technologies and they have the perfect laboratory, as it were, with the pandemic to test out these new apps, other kinds of technologies of surveillance, kind of strategies for governance. So it's a kind of maybe not the kind of convergence which and the bridging of the climate change and global health realms that we wanted to see, but it's definitely one of the more prominent ways in which these two realms are being understood in the same way and being seen through the same kind of technological lens, being apprehended in the same way. But we are out of time, so I want to take this opportunity to first of all, thank the panelists. Thank you very much for your time and for providing really fascinating presentations. I want to thank the audience who are joining us from different parts of the world. But I also want to take a minute to thank the India-China Institute's team headed by Grace Howe and Michael in our IT department, who always ensures that these webinars take place seamlessly. So thank you very much, and hopefully we'll see you in our next panel too.